Good morning and a warm welcome to the 19th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private, and are members content to take agenda item 3 in private?
Yes.
Thank you. Agenda item 2 is to take evidence on our culture in the communities inquiry, which is focused on taking a place-based approach to culture. And this morning we're joined by Alistair Evans, who's the Interim Director of Strategy and Planning at Creative Scotland, morning, and Karen Dick, Head of Place, Partnerships and Communities at Creative Scotland. And we're not having opening statements this morning, as you have submitted written evidence to the committee, and thank you for that. So if we can move to questions, could I open with the Scottish Government's Culture Strategy, committed to working with Creative Scotland to do a map of local authority support to culture and to explore future models of collaboration between the national and local bodies. And I wonder if you could just give us an update on how this work is progressing.
Yes, I can start with that. So we began with that work, which is around mapping the structures and financial channels in the sector, how we all work as national bodies with public bodies in the period before the pandemic, and had made some progress with that, which was with other priorities clearly through the pandemic deprioritised. So we're returning to that this year, and we can say a bit more about the plans for that. But I wanted to be clear about that piece of work. It is not a spatial planning piece. It's not an asset register of all the cultural assets across Scotland, which we do at a local level in a lot of our work, that kind of mapping, but it's not intended to be a piece of work that maps everything in Scotland on a map.
Thank you. Some of the committee had a visit in Edinburgh to a couple of culture areas, one of which was Wester Hales, the Whale Arts Centre.
Yes.
We're also, when you say that about it not being an asset register, that's obviously very much a cultural centre at the heart of a community. But we also found out about them opening up empty units in the local area and with other organisations, partner organisations, and indeed the collective actually opening us in within the shopping centre. And how do we actually get a view of what's happening across Scotland if there isn't a sort of feed into local authorities and yourselves about all of these different strands of culture in the community that are happening? Do you think Creative Scotland's aware enough of initiatives like that in their communities?
Yeah, I think I'll just take that. One of the things that we do at Creative Scotland is to, apart from being through all of our colleagues and the people that work in Creative Scotland and Screen Scotland, and the connections that they have through funding, development and advocacy work that they do, one of the ways that we understand what's happening in local authority areas or in communities is through briefings that are created by my team, which we call the local authority briefings, the area briefings. And these contain information on not just what Creative Scotland funds, but what how much funding goes in from the local authority, the major assets and festivals, down to film locations and areas that have been used as filming locations, to capital investment that has gone in from the National Lottery Fund through the Scottish Arts Council since the lottery began in 1995. And we have all of that information contained in briefings and things. There's no substitute though for the work that we do in talking to people, going out into communities, attending things like funding fairs, excuse me, and the general work that we do in through our people that apply to us for funding and us responding to to their things. And as you mentioned, WHALE are part of the Culture Collective programme, which is 26 lead organisations and their partners across communities in Scotland working together in communities.
And specifically on the Edinburgh example, while we wouldn't look to have a national asset register because of the scale of resource required for that and the upkeep, which would, you'll appreciate, be an almost daily task with the team required. When we're working locally, those exercises can be hugely helpful to have all the partners around the table and mapping not only the assets that we know about, but ones that the local community feel could be brought back into use. So exactly your example from vacant shopping centre lots, for example.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Yeah, I'm just building on that. I'm interested to kind of know where creative community hubs really sit within your strategy as an organisation and how you would consider funding them going forward within your new funding model that I think you're developing. So we were quite struck last week with some of the work that's been happening across Edinburgh to effectively reset the relationship between creative community hubs and agencies, particularly the Working Better Together report, and perhaps the sense that many of these community hubs feel that, you know, cultural opportunities are being sort of offered to them, but they're not being developed from the ground up. It's not really a community development approach that's happening right now. And there's been other evidence, you know, we've seen from University of Stirling, looking at Creative Stirling, for example, how creative hubs have pivoted during COVID to take a much more inclusive approach, a much more of a community development approach. Does that fit with the funds that you have, or does that start to stray into other siloed boxes like regeneration? Or so how are you actually incorporating something which is much more holistic, much more about placemaking into your kind of central funding, which is about culture, but is about much more than that?
I think there's many examples of that within our funding mix. So obviously we are approaching a period where we will ourselves reset our relationships with a group of multi-year funded organisations. Some of those are larger organisations that we all know very well, but many of them are also community organisations that are working in exactly the settings that you're talking about. Beyond that, our open funding picks up many of these types of community hubs, and we fund some of the networks, whether that's Creative Edinburgh, Creative Dundee, or organisations like Charts and Argyll and Bute. Awards for All is another one that is much more of a small grants scheme, so typically within that you'd be seeing choirs, local halls, other kind of settings funded, and we have a range of devolved funds that work in that way. I think Culture Collective, which the committee's obviously heard quite a lot about, but also our place partnerships, that kind of targeted work brings a lot of organisations and settings of that scale into our funding mix.
Mm-hmm. It's okay, you don't need to switch.
Yeah, I think, as Alistair says there, it's a lot of a mix of things. I think you'll find in a lot of those community-focused organisations that you might have visited or heard from before, many of them are funded by Creative Scotland through many different routes. We've supported Creative Stirling through some of our targeted routes, through our Place Partnership and through our Creative Industries team to develop their work, particularly looking at how they support makers and people who are living and creating things to sell or developing creative businesses in Stirling, as well as the work that they do directly with communities. And I think all of these types of activity fit within some of our funding streams at some point, or with other funding programmes that are out there that aren't necessarily Creative Scotland funded, because there are other lottery funders like the National Lottery Community Fund, National Lottery Heritage Fund, who also support cultural activity, especially in the National Lottery Community Fund, where it has got a specific community focus, rather than, say, for Creative Scotland, it would be about a creative focus.
Yeah. Do you think there's a tension between perhaps, you know, large cultural organisations and festivals like the Fringe that want to invest in communities, but sometimes that can feel very top-down. It can very much feel like, well, look, here's 60 tickets to come and see something that we're producing. So one of the views from the Edinburgh Creative Hubs, the quote here was, if you want the margins to engage, then invest in the margins. It's quite straightforward. Is the balance right there? Is culture something that is kind of being, I wouldn't say done to people, but sort of, you know, offered to people, or is it something that can emerge from communities? Is that partnership right? Because I think the view that we had is that sometimes it's not. It's seen as kind of a type of philanthropy. You know, would you like to come see our show rather than, you know, what is it that you're creating in your community, and how can we invest and develop that?
Yeah, I think there's multiple different ways that manifests itself throughout Scotland. And one of the things I think that Culture Collective was that we developed Culture Collective to be able to do was to allow that the communities, so the work developed through Culture Collective is created by the communities with the artists, with the organisations supporting them all, and that is intended to, if not maybe redress the balance in some areas, but to give a voice where there might not have been a voice before. And in some cases there are examples of what might be felt as if it is that sort of more, we are doing good to communities, we're offering you something, come and see it, without maybe understanding what that community needs or what that unmet need is in that community. And there are multiple different ways of doing things. Sometimes you know, tickets to a show is exactly what people need, but that doesn't mean they don't need something else alongside that to be able to then develop what they want, or to have that control over what they need in their place.
So if you recognise that, what role can Creative Scotland play in terms of helping to perhaps reset or at least question that relationship, that partnership, about whether it's working in certain areas?
Yeah, I think it's a really good question, I guess, to the heart of how we try to work and embed place-based cultural strategy into everything that we do. Part of that is through our funding, part of that is through development programmes, through place partnership and place partnerships and other programmes. But we would, everything that we see, and whether it's a funding application or work that we're doing from a development perspective, we would be looking to see exactly what you described, organic need and opportunity described by communities and projects that are going to co-create with them. And we are very vigilant to projects and applications that would parachute into areas or where that relationship is imbalanced, when it's about an organisation coming into community and saying, there's an offer here for you, rather than saying to the community, what is it that your community wants or needs, and how can we work together to help deliver that? So it's at the heart of it. And you mentioned COVID. I think COVID and the response from the cultural sector, which, you know, was extraordinary in some places in terms of how they pivoted both to offer cultural activity to their communities, but also to provide a wider civic service. I think that's really focused minds on that. We're doing some work with the University of Manchester on what they called it, the civic turn in cultural policy, their term, not ours, because I think in Scotland, culture has very much had a civic role for a very long time. Mm. And we can see changes, for example, in Edinburgh, in the evaluation of the PLACE programme, which involves all of the Edinburgh festivals in part in community activity. We can see that change as that has progressed in how they approach community groups, or how they let community groups approach them and co-create with them. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you. we don't really want today to be about funding, but inevitably it comes up. But just in the back of Mr. Ruskell's line of questioning, and you talked about the pivot that organisations had. We've heard lots of evidence about how organisations felt COVID reset a relationship with the funders for that time, where they became trusted organisations when, you know, all of a sudden the restrictions on how the money could be used, the projects where they could, all that kind of eased off, and it gave an opportunity for the organisations to use their own creativity to deliver, as you said, both a cultural but also a civic and wellbeing service to many of the communities. And that's something that the organisations are saying, you know, we would like to feel that. But they're back to the funding cycle and the checkbox exercises, they would call it. And has Creative Scotland reflected on that in the way it's actually asking people to bid for funding now, and how you're assessing projects? And is there any opportunity for multi-year funding for some of the organisations that are trusted partners?
Yes, I think Culture Collective is a very good example of where we set a programme without a set objectives. So, and Karen can speak in much more detail about that approach. But the broader point, obviously there was significant emergency funds through that period. We needed to disperse them at speed. So our approach was to assure that we had accountability for those funds, but to prioritise getting them to those organisations. We are back in a position where our funds are highly, highly competitive. Our open fund, I don't think in over 10 years at Creative Scotland I've seen it so competitive. And the committee will know the position with our regularly funded organisations and with our overall funding picture. So it's extremely competitive. In that kind of environment, it is, in order for us to make fine-tuned decisions about who we fund, we're going to continue to require to see how those organisations are helping us to meet our shared objectives for the sector. So I'd like to say that, yes, it would be easier to secure funds from us in the wake of COVID, but that is not always the case. But for targeted funds like Culture Collective, we've been able to, I think, be less prescriptive about the outcomes that we're looking for in communities.
Yes, particularly for Culture Collective. When we were designing the fund, the key point for us was that we didn't want to see predetermined outcomes, because the outcomes should be determined through working in with those communities. And the only metric, as Catherine Melcher, our programme lead, mentioned, the only metric we really have for Culture Collective that involves numbers is the number of freelancers or creative practitioners employed by Culture Collective. The reporting that we have, which is fairly extensive, the organisations want to tell us the story, the coordinators want to tell us the story of what the funding is doing, how it is supporting artists and communities, how it is changing, how it's developing, how they are learning from each other, and how they are changing as organisations or as individuals, and how they're developing what they're doing in the future. I, through the Culture Collective programme, through the Place Partnership programme, we are particularly flexible about how we define things, how we report and what we expect, because very much partnership working is about that long-term approach. It's about understanding and flexing where the need is, which is what we can do when there is when we have a targeted fund, when we have a model like that. When there's extreme pressure on budgets, when budgets are at standstill and there's a lot of applications and very hard decisions to make, it's not quite as easy as having those very open, flexible ways of working. But I would say for any applications or any awards that we make, if people need to make changes to budgets, if they need to change what they're doing halfway through a project, they can always come and talk to us. They will have a named contact who they can get in touch with, and we are very open to them changing things to suit what they need to do for that project, as long as it's not completely changing what it was funded for, because that would be a bigger issue.
And just sorry, on your final point, which I realise I hadn't answered fully, on eligibility for multi-year funding, absolutely. Organisations whose work might be described as more community-focused are eligible. The the processes will be built to ensure there's no bias towards any organisational type. There are many organisations, as you'll know, within the current RFO portfolio whose work is focused in this way, whether it's Stove or Timespan or Wigtown, that are completely embedded within their communities, and it's absolutely what they do.
Thank you. Dr. Atwood.
Thank you. I suppose building on what Mark Ruskell was asking there, it's about responsiveness to local communities' needs, and specifically the fact that not all culture takes place within a theatre or within a traditional cultural venue. I suppose I'm thinking of traditional culture, but this could apply to all sorts of local culture. In terms of how you approach things nationally, how do you recognise that fact?
We do absolutely recognise that fact, and a useful illustration of that, I think, is the Scottish Household Survey, which asked the population about how they engage with cultural assets, be that a theatre or a gallery, and that's very useful data for us. But we also run our own population survey where we ask people about how they conceive themselves of their cultural lives, and they consistently tell us not only about going to theatres and art galleries, but about the gardening that they do and the baking that they do and the DIY that they do. So there's a very strong sense of everyday participation. You spoke with Andrew Miles here. We part-funded that project looking at everyday participation. And the conclusion of that, which we would agree with, is that people engage culturally on their doorstep, or in their homes and on their doorstep. So we are mindful of that in everything that we fund, and making sure that people can engage at a local level.
Part of that everyday participation study, it looked at, when we became involved in it, it looked at Coulter in Aberdeen and also at Stornoway, because we were really keen to put forward examples into that UK-wide study that included different languages, different cultural ways of taking part in culture, and an island location and places that were maybe not in the centre of an urban environment, so that there was that wide look at, you know, how people take part in cultural activities and creative activities in different places with different approaches. Through some of the work that we do in Place Partnerships and Communities team, which covers Gaelic arts, Scots, traditional arts, as well as partnerships with local authorities and ways like that, we do get to see how different organisations and different people and different places want to take part in things. And I think it's really key to say here is that we don't only fund organisations that are and work with organisations who would maybe typically be described as cultural organisations. There are community organisations who support cultural activity because they see it as a core thing that they do and they want to do for their community. And especially when you're looking at rural or smaller parts of the country, a lot of the organisations that are going to be delivering things for communities are going to be also delivering leisure activities or community-focused support. They might have a bakery. There are lots of different things, I think, how we understand what a cultural opportunity or how people take part in culture in different communities across Scotland is as wide and varied as the different opportunities across Scotland.
Thank you.
Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about venues, please? During our inquiry, we've heard a lot about the importance of local venues, cultural venues, and as the convener said, the committee's taken visits in Edinburgh last week, and then in Dumfries and Orkney in the following weeks. But we've heard that many venues are under threat. I'm sure that's no surprise to you. There are lots of reasons for that: local authority closures, funding issues, the rationalisation of the Church of Scotland estate has also been mentioned. Lots of pressures. And we also have heard that many community groups feel under pressure to rescue the local venue, whatever that might be. and that there is subsequent huge responsibility on them for both running these as assets. Can I ask what work is Creative Scotland doing to help communities in that particular endeavour?
I think it's one of the things I would say is it's not Creative Scotland's role to provide support and advice around community asset transfer and things like that. There are other people out there that are much better qualified and much more experienced than us to do things like that. But particularly when we are talking to people or when people are approaching us for advice, quite often that can be around. There is a church or there's a well of building at the end of our street, and it is likely to be sold off to developers, and we think it should be a cultural space. And you know, we do have colleagues inside Creative Scotland who can give advice and support, and we don't have a capital programme ourselves, particularly if a building needs that refurbishment, but we can highlight other funders or other organisations that can provide that advice and play that connecting role as a national body, where it's either pointing to examples of when people have taken on assets, the challenges and opportunities that that brings, or pointing them to other bodies or other people that can help and advise. What I would say is that very often, particularly if it comes to people divesting themselves of these assets, they have a challenge in and of themselves in managing assets, and passing that challenge on to community groups, and to particularly where those community groups may be volunteer-led, it can be extremely challenging for them to take that on without further funding, advice, support, information on how to manage a building, and then that future ongoing support there. There are instances where we have supported programmes that run in some of these assets or some of these places that have been taken over by communities or by creative groups. However, it has to be about the programme that they're running rather than just that retention of an asset. And it is unfortunate in some places where communities lose key community assets because they are bought up by developers or developed into housing. And I think that is one of the things, as Alistair said earlier, around that civic role, where we find civic space, where communities find space to take part in things, to come together. There's a lot of that being lost due to the changes and everything in the estates and things that you mentioned. But it really is key to make sure that when people are thinking about taking on assets and thinking about taking control of these buildings, that they understand what they're, you know, letting themselves in for, essentially. In our Aberdeen Place partnership, one of the things that was developed through that was a programme around for individuals who were thinking about taking on assets. And it took them through, very, very tailored, it took them through what they might need to do, the challenges, the legal responsibilities, how they might form into a KIC or into a charity, etc. And at the start of that, there were quite a few people interested in taking on specific assets in Aberdeen, and at the end, there was only one, because it is a massive challenge and it will change what those individuals and groups are doing, and it can take them away, particularly if they have come together, like the Stove in Dumfries, when they came together as individual artists because they were concerned about losing that high street property. It took them away from their individual day-to-day roles as artists and as developers, and there's only or as people who are developing their own creative practice. There's only so long that, you know, some people can do, you know, suddenly change from being a maker and an artist into managing a capital development, when it might not be what you want to do with your life, but you definitely want to make sure your community doesn't lose it.
I entirely take the point about, you know, it's not just about taking on a building or whatever, and it depends on what is going on, what you are using it for. But in terms of what Creative Scotland likes to see prioritised, do you have any kind of criteria that you particularly like communities taking on venues to progress?
I think that would be entirely up to that community. So if they were applying to us for funding, which is quite often how we engage with people, although we do support development, we do advise and support, if they're applying for us for funding, our funding criteria are on the site, and it would be about, you know, the type of work that they are putting on, how they've understood the demand for that. But quite often people might want to test and try different things to see what a community, what their audience or what participants might want, especially if it's a new space. And so instead of maybe coming in for large programmes of work, trying and testing different things to see what sticks and see what communities might want to do, looking at what other people have developed in places. But anyone that's applying for us, we wouldn't expect different things from different people when it comes to our criteria. But it is all down to that local context and how they express that in an application and how people, how they've understood what the need is locally.
Yeah. I'm very, very glad to hear that answer. Can I move on to a slightly different topic? Sorry.
Yeah. Then it's a supplementary. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Deputy Convener. Good morning to the panel. I just wanted to build on some of those, I think, very important points around assets. And I just wondered if there's any more that you may want to add around how together we will be benefited by urging developers and organisations with space to consider the creative community as a new group of tenants or a different utilisation for properties that they have. And I represent Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, and that's something I do on a regular basis, and we've seen the benefit of such entities in Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, whether it's Out of the Blue or initiatives that WASPs and Edinburgh Palette have undertaken, for example. So, and the reason I emphasise that is that clearly, and it's been highlighted to us by Professor Stevenson and the evidence he gave, that a key issue is meeting overheads. So the more that those core costs can be shared, how beneficial is that to the creative community, and how together can we potentially do more to urge private sector developers and indeed the public sector to utilise space to provide areas for creative businesses and organisations where they can potentially have somebody else manage those core costs and or share them.
I think it's a perennial problem there around when you have an asset and people want, if they're private developers or if they're public, they want to be able to have an income from it or to sell it or to raise money from it. And you mentioned WASPs there, and quite often WASPs have had in the past a challenge in explaining to where there is an empty space or an empty building, actually, if we had access to this, we could take it on and then we can bring our artists in, and that will have a beneficial impact. I think as time has gone on and that model has sort of proven itself, it has become a lot clearer to people that the potential benefits of having a creative community developing, of bringing people together in one place. Edinburgh Palette's a really good example of a space that was a meanwhile space. It was waiting, awaiting development, and then came in and, you know, bringing everyone together in one place where there was demand. And I think that's the key point here, is about if there's demand from a creative community in order to access things, how we negotiate those relationships between businesses or organisations that own property in order to bring people in and explain that benefit. It's a challenge. It's a challenge for us. It's a challenge for the creative community. It's a challenge for local authorities and for other people. One of the key things I think are the places that have been helpful in negotiating those relationships have been things like local authority arts development officers or people in local areas who can actually be that conduit between businesses or owners or local authority landlords and the creative sector, where they want to come in and do things, and they can help to sort of translate and explain the benefits of that. And that's one of the impacts of the loss of arts development officers in many parts of Scotland, is that there isn't that conduit between the landlords and the owners and then the creative communities to be able to explain that benefit there. It is something that we have looked at, something that many of our place partnerships have looked at, particularly in places like Inverclyde, where there are large spaces, where creative communities do want to have ownership and go into some of those spaces. It has been successful in some places, but there is also the fact that those are quite often temporary spaces that then may be lost once the opportunity, planning permission comes through for a developer to develop things. I would be really interested in further discussion about this. I think there's work that we've done in certain parts of the organisation, particularly in visual arts, around what artists need and what spaces they need, that would be potentially interesting to try and see what we can do together.
Yeah, I think that there is a more general point here about the profile of culture and the local planning landscape. So, as you'll know, the definition of local authority requirement for adequate cultural provision means that sometimes we don't, as a culture sector, have the profile that we would like. Greater Scotland's not a statutory consultee in community planning partnerships, and so sometimes it does feel like we need to be knocking on the door from the outside to get into some of these conversations at a local level, and economic development's been part of that, and ensuring that we're in those conversations. Our creative industries team are adept at getting themselves into those conversations where they can, but I think that wider point is salient here as well.
I'm interested, Mr. Bibbian. We'll come back to Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. In response to Mr. Cameron, Ms. Dickey said we don't have a capital programme. I hear what you're saying about there being other funding sources available for capital funds, but given the scale of the challenges that are, as outlined by Mr. Cameron, in terms of cultural venues, should the Creative Scotland not have a cultural capital programme? Is that something that has been considered? Is being considered or will be considered?
I'm going to pass to Alistair. Answer that one.
Yes, so our from the advent of lottery in the 90s, our capital investment has been significant, over £150 million, but that has leveraged in more than double that, and we've evaluated that or reviewed the extent of that investment, and I think it's somewhere in the region of 140 projects around Scotland that we've invested in, so absolutely significant. We don't have a capital programme, as you say, at the moment, so the options for those looking for capital support would be into Scottish Government, Heritage Lottery, levelling up at a UK level has capital funds. So there are routes, but the eligibility for some of those schemes and the competitive nature of them does mean that it's extremely difficult to get capital funding. Our funding mix at the moment doesn't allow for that. We don't have restricted capital funds from Scottish Government, and our national lottery funding is now very much focused on our open project funds for individuals and organisations, which are heavily oversubscribed. It is a concern that we have. We've, I think, on a few levels. So certainly the fabric of the building of the asset base around Scotland, and that's not just Victorian theatres, but much newer buildings as well. So there's a need for repair, renovation, for small capital and equipment funds, and we're doing some further work to try and quantify that. It will not be a small number, as I'm sure you'll appreciate, and a particular focus at the moment is on net zero. So not only do we have an estate that is looking for investment, but also needs to adapt to meet net zero for 2045 and for 2030 for the targets, as you know, for Glasgow and Edinburgh. So we're beginning work on that. We've appointed an officer who's looking specifically at the climate emergency and working with partner organisations to try and understand more about what building adaptation needs to take place.
Thanks. Mr. Cameron.
Thank you. Could I just move on to the issues of mapping and collaboration? I know you've touched on mapping already, but one of the actions in the culture strategy for Scotland was to, and I quote, work with Creative Scotland to map local authorities' support for culture and to explore future models of collaboration between national and local bodies. I don't think you mentioned that in your written submission to this inquiry. And I just wondered if you could take the opportunity now to make any observations on that particular sentence in the strategy.
Yeah, I think Alistair mentioned just at the beginning that we had been working on the research and the report pre-pandemic. In March 2020, we had a completed report from the consultants who had spoken to the local authorities and to discuss that, and we were in the process of... We actually had in the diary a meeting with local authorities in order to discuss that report, discuss the findings, and then publish it. But what we wanted to do was publish it alongside an action plan, which said what we were going to do going forward alongside the Scottish Government. Unfortunately, that was in March 2020. And then we became fully focused on delivering the emergency funding support through Creative Scotland. And there's been significant pressure on local authorities and ALIOs, the cultural trusts. So it hasn't really... There wasn't really a gap between then and now when we could really sit down with our local authority partners and start to map out why do they want to work with us now. Things have also considerably changed in the financial context. And the report covers the finances of local authorities, staffing. But really importantly, we were asking local authorities and ALIOs how they wanted to work with us in future, what the different things that they wanted us to do were. Things have now changed. And it is in our work plan for this year to revisit that and look at what the next steps are there. And hopefully we can do that through with colleagues in COSLA, in Vocal, in Community Leisure UK and in SOLAS alongside Scottish Government. But it is one of those things that were had to be put aside because of the pandemic. And we do recognise that the context and local authorities has significantly changed. So a lot of the data that we have there is potentially no longer relevant.
So we at the point that we had a draft report, we were looking at a decrease of around 16 million in local authority culture budgets. These figures are, and that was over a five-year period. These figures are really very difficult to get at. Quite substantial forensic accounting needs to be undertaken to understand that. We would expect, unfortunately, that position to be even more challenging, I think, at this point, and we need to return to that and understand it. Another point just worth picking up is we are waiting to see a revised culture strategy action plan from the culture team in Scottish Government. We're hoping that that will set out the responsibilities and the delivery mechanisms and the monitoring, etc., on the culture strategy. We believe that will be published shortly, and that's important because it will absolutely set out the context that this piece of mapping work will progress from.
Thank you for those answers. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I wonder if just on reflection on what you've just said, if you look to the example of Sport Scotland and the strategy position they have for being involved in community plan partnerships, quite similar in that they also have a responsibility for elite sport, which could be seen as the sort of like the national performing companies and other work that you do, but also grassroots areas at the bottom. Are you kind of a wee bit jealous of their position in local authorities, and do you think it would help if Creative Scotland was on the same footing in terms of the wellbeing society and where we want to move forward?
I think we're on record as saying we'd be positive about being a statutory partner in community planning. Sport Scotland, Historic Environment Scotland, others are more engaged on that level. It doesn't stop us, I don't think, working very effectively with all local authorities and helping them develop their strategies and plans. But it does give rise to the potential for uneven strategic locus across the country, which would be our concern. And often, I think the briefing that SPICE provided to you for this meeting highlighted that the local output and outcome improvement plans don't always mention culture. Now, they may have cultural plans and cultural strategies that sit to the side of that, but we would want to see them being absolutely there and central. So, yes, I mean, the more central we can be to local planning protocols, then the better, really.
Thank you. Mr. Golden.
Thanks, convener. I'd like to explore two separate questions. So, first of all, in your submission, you mention an example of place-based partnerships is the development of the Angus Cultural Strategy. Mm-hmm. But just this week, it was revealed the degree to which Creative Scotland is funding Scotland's cities over smaller rural areas. And it was highlighted that Creative Scotland were spending £50.85 per resident on projects in Edinburgh, while in Angus spending was only £4.09 per resident. I just wondered whether Creative Scotland recognised this as a major issue, and how would you propose to adopt a place-based approach to culture when funding is so skewed away from rural areas such as Angus?
We both have perspectives on this. Yes, thanks for that. I think we appreciate that this is an issue that comes up with us often. Part of it relates to the data and what's available and how we publish it. So we can talk a bit about that. And some is there's some assumptions that are made about how we fund and the landscape that we fund into that it's also worth picking up. But we do recognise that we don't fund by formula. We don't, whether that's per head or, you know, across the equitable amount to the 32 local authorities or by any other formula. So, and that there are structural barriers in place. So we fund against the ask of us from across the country. And a lot of the development work that we do is about improving the numbers and rates of people that feel comfortable applying into our funds, right, from small grants right through to our RFOs. But maybe if I can pick up on the data, I mean, we don't feel that our investment is skewed across the country. We recognise that Glasgow and Edinburgh have high levels of funding from us, but there are a lot of national organisations that have their base there. There's a lot of touring organisations that have their base there, and they are places where artists do congregate and collect, and networks will from those areas will come to into us. There are organisations like Trax based in Edinburgh, and Trax obviously working in traditional arts across Scotland. There are quirks in the data, so Aberdeenshire appears with an Aberdeen postcode. A lot of grants into island communities appear as Inverness, for example. So we recognise that, and we're in the process of digitising a lot of our operational systems, so we recognise that we can be better at explaining where the areas of benefit are rather than just the postcode location of where the grant is made. And so when analysis like the example that you were giving about Fife and Angus, that's drawn from our website and it relates to the postcode of the applicant. So there's quite a lot in there. And as I say, I think we can improve it. But I think there's some assumptions as well about how we fund, effectively about the landscape that we're funding into.
I think it's important to note that Creative Scotland is not the only funder or supporter of culture or cultural activity. The local authority, third sector, commercial businesses and other funders like Museums Gallery Scotland, the National Arts Heritage Fund and Community Fund, and they all together make an example, basically bring together what happens in a place and the types of cultural activity, the opportunities for people in a place. And I think particularly if using Angus as an example, one of the reasons that we developed the Angus Place Partnership there was to, as an opportunity, which is often a route into police partnerships, but it also recognises perhaps where we might have less applications from, where there might not necessarily no longer be an arts development function within a local authority. And these are some of the criteria for our police partnership targeted programme, where there's an opportunity for us to be part of something to help bring people together across an area to look at what the challenges are and how they can address them. So for Angus, it was the celebration of the declaration of our growth. So that was a route in where we could support with our funding and alongside other partners, a sort of more raising of the visibility of culture within that place, support particularly the delivery of a small grants scheme, which then can quite often give people their first opportunity to apply for funding. And to quite often people might look at Creative Scotland and think, that's not for me, that's for somebody else. I would never have a chance, or they wouldn't support my type of project. And by having small grants in small areas, or in those areas, and particularly focused at that first step and encouraging people and having that development wraparound that quite often can only happen when people are able to connect locally, then we can actually build that capacity and support more applications to come from that area. In Angus, we also were working with Angus Alive, the Cultural Trust, who have now brought in people's focused on developing culture and are continuing to deliver and support the delivery of the culture and heritage strategy. So I think there are differences across the country. We wouldn't ever say there isn't. We don't fund on a per capita basis. We don't analyse our funding on a per capita basis. I much prefer to look at success rates, because that tells me how people are applying, whether we have, with any interventions, whether it's going out to funding fairs and being in Solcoats and answering questions from anyone that comes into that building, along with other funders. Have we helped to change things? Are we getting more applications from an area? Are we getting more successful applications from an area? Because then you can actually see things change and develop. However, as with anything, Creative Scotland's budget has not increased. So when we are going out and doing that development work and encouraging people to apply, are we essentially setting them up to then be unsuccessful because we can't support everything? So there is that, you know, when we are encouraging and supporting people to raise applications from a place, we are very aware as well that our funding is not increasing, and, you know, the challenge that we have to support as much as that we want to support is very difficult.
Thanks for that. That's
got three members indicating supplementaries in that area. So if you don't mind, before you go on to the next topic, Dr. Allen first, please.
I would appreciate, you know, I agree with the point you're making there, that obviously some of the funding for the big cities reflects the fact that people come into the big cities to access stuff. But when you're measuring success rates, do you also take account of the fact that there are some parts of the country, and I represent the Western Isles, where visiting those places would involve an overnight stay, and where therefore it's just out of people's reach? So that's not a case against the centres of excellence that we have in the Burrell Collection or the National Museum of Scotland, but are we measuring success in terms of actually allowing people to access those national assets when they come from places that are so far away that an overnight stay is involved?
I think it would be interesting maybe to see out what we think about success, but I would also point to things like the Travelling Gallery and the things that we fund, because we don't fund the Burrell Collection or the museums, but the Travelling Gallery, which we do fund, which takes amazing art out in the back of a lorry in the same way that the Screen Machine does for cinema, and is one of my favourite things ever, because it's a cinema in a lorry.
I've seen Star Wars in it in Barra.
I saw Brave at in Dorney, and also The Constant Gardener in, when it was covering for the Eden Court redevelopment a very long time ago. Screen Machine won. But I think those types of activity are really key in doing that, and it does recognise that actually for some places, and you know, if the committee are thinking about things like 20-minute neighbourhoods, etc., quite often my response to things like 20-minute neighbourhoods is, you know, if you are in Thurso and you want to go to the cinema, you know, going to Eden Court can be, for some places in the islands, a 4-hour, 5-hour drive there, never mind back. So it is an overnight stay. So I think there is a real question to be had about how we support things in communities that are very far away from other places, how we support island communities. And there is a recognition that we have that there are additional costs, particularly in bringing things to islands or for people on islands touring or taking things away because of the cost of travel, because of the costs of overnight stays, and also because of the challenges as well in some parts of Scotland of finding accommodation, of you know, the barriers that can happen with travel and with weather, etc. So all of these things are taken into account when we consider applications, but also when we are looking at where funding goes. It's one of the reasons why we don't do per capita spend, because that we'd always skew the small populations to the top of the list, even though you know, they may get a very, very small amount compared to other places.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Ruskell?
Just wondering, on the back of that, if there are particular barriers in terms of scale and capacity of organisations, particularly those in rural areas, which might lend themselves to be quite suited to applying for a small grant scheme, but perhaps less suited to applying for a bigger level of project. And I'm thinking in particular about core funding. So, you know, easy for organisations to apply for a wee small project, but if the core funding isn't there for investment in their building an asset or management or cleaners or paying for heating and all of that, then they're never really going to get to a point where they can actually come to you with a bigger, more transformative application to serve their communities.
I think, you know, it is a consideration, although many of the organisations that we currently fund through our regular funding portfolio are based in more rural areas. I'm lead officer for Timespan up in Helmsdale in the Highlands, and they provide a programme of cutting-edge, challenging contemporary art within the Art and Heritage Centre that they're based in. It can take some time and lots of development for people to get to a stage where they apply for bigger grants, and quite often the first step is to have a small grant through a more open programme, and then, you know, have a few of those and then apply for larger scale funding. However, if people have got really strong plans and really strong aims, programmes, engagement with their community, there shouldn't be anything stopping them from applying for that, as long as they can demonstrate they can manage the funding.
Do you recognise that the core funding issue is a big issue, and perhaps this isn't just about rural arts community hubs, it's about urban as well? Like, if the money isn't there to employ a manager, to employ that core staff, then everybody's running around writing short-term applications for project funding, but there ain't anybody to run the show.
We recognise that we're committed to providing multi-year funding, which would include core element, for as many organisations as we can. So this autumn we will open application to our regularly to our multi-year funding programmes, so the current RFOs and others that will want to reapply. It will be inevitably really competitive. I think we think in the region of around 350 organisations will be expected to apply for that. But we undertook a funding review after the last exercise in 2018, and that was one of the big messages that came out of that, the demand for exactly as you say, that stability for organisations not to be moving from project to project and be making repeated applications to us and other funders for that. It will be completely dependent on the budget envelope that we have at that point, the extent to which we can make good on that and offer that multi-year funding to as many organisations as possible, but it's absolutely our intention to do so. Geography is a really important lens in that process, and we'd be making sure throughout our RFO assessment and the decisions that we have to take to prioritise within it, that geography is considered. And as Karen says, there's organisations like Northlands Glass, for example, would be another one, as well as Timespan, that are remote, and we recognise the need for them to access core funding to survive.
I think it's a really strong message that's come through in a lot of our evidence sessions, not least of which were our sessions in Edinburgh on Friday. And one of the board members of Well Arts described it as donut funding, basically. And over time, it just diminishes the organisation not to have that core element, and almost exacerbated if there's a building associated with an organisation. But even for those that don't have responsibility for a building, you know, that key administration management strategy element had to be supported as well. I'm going to come back to Mr Golden, and I'll bring in Mr Bibby, if that's okay. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Alistair, earlier in the session you mentioned about meeting net zero, and I just wondered if you could outline what that looks like for Creative Scotland, what costs have been configured to date, and just perhaps elucidate a bit more on your plans.
So, as I said, we've appointed a lead in this area of our work, but it's not entirely new to us. We've worked on this for a significant amount of time. The climate emergency and environmental sustainability is one of our four strategic priorities. A lot of that work has been done through Creative Carbon Scotland, who are a key organisation to provide support to the sector. And they do a range of development work, policy development, but they also importantly manage the process of collecting data from creative organisations in the sector, which over time has given us the footprint, the carbon footprint for the sector, and other important data around energy. That's part of our strategy. So the Climate Emergency Sustainability Plan was published just over a year ago. It's extremely ambitious, I think 70 or 80 action points, most for us, but there isn't really any point in being anything other than hugely ambitious in this space when you look at the timeframes. So some of our ambitions are around mitigation, others are around adaptation, and others are around the just transition and ensuring that the that climate justice is ingrained in everything that we do. I think the first of those, I'm not saying it's the easiest, but it's the one that we have more of a handle on and can be quantified. As I said earlier, we're starting some work to try and understand what building adaptation might look like, the potential of digital, an understanding of the travel footprint of the sector. So obviously we're a sector with huge international ambitions, and we want Scotland's diverse culture to be visible all around the world. That has a carbon footprint attached to it. So how can we work smarter in that space as well? So we're addressing all those issues. We're not doing it alone. So a lot of what we're doing is bringing people together in cohorts to from the sector to look for creative responses to these challenges. The sector is uniquely placed to vision what that would be, and actually to bring the public around some of those ideas. So it's not just about our buildings, it's about the content on stage, for example, and the issues being raised by our RFOs, and many are already in that space.
And many, actually, just to come in there, some of our culture collective projects, organisations are really focused on this work. Creative Dundee, for example, and their Cultivate project, and Open Road in Aberdeen and Fitty, where quite a lot of, you know, their work and their project in Fitty was looking at, you know, a community that is on the edge that might be immediately, you know, one of the first affected by climate change, and by that impact, not just on with their being a coastal community, but the issues with oil and with the potential, you know, changes to the economic infrastructure of the city that they are part of. So there are a lot of, as Alistair says, creative organisations that are really already engaged looking at this and trying to vision what the future might be.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Fitt.
Thank you, Convener. As we've just discussed, there has been concerns raised with us about the concerns over the unfairness of funding distribution. And one specific concern that I'm aware of is about the disparity of funding between the areas that sell the most national lottery tickets and the areas that receive the most national lottery funding. That was something that was reinforced to us by community organisations in areas of multiple deprivation last week. I just wanted to ask you, is this something you recognise? What analysis, if any, have you done of this disparity between areas that sell the most national lottery tickets and get the most national lottery funding? And you've mentioned a number of factors you take into account when you allocate funding, geography. Do you factor in this?
Yeah, I think whether we've done the exact analysis between lottery sales and the provision of culture generally, or the level of investment by Creative Scotland, we probably haven't done it in that level of detail, but the linkage that you've described is there in terms of lottery sales being highest in areas of multiple deprivation, and we absolutely do understand the landscape in terms of the index of multiple deprivation and where we fund. And yes, it's a concern when we consider where need and opportunity is in everything that we do. And you know, we have been partners on numerous regeneration projects, which is appreciate is probably only the tip of the iceberg. But many other initiatives as well that specifically target deprived groups.
Yeah, and I think that point around, you know, lottery sales versus lottery investment, again, you know, I think sometimes postcode doesn't necessarily tell the whole story here, because we fund the data that we provide is of the postcode of the applicant, not necessarily where activity takes place. And when you look at our the organisations we fund or the individuals we fund, often they might not exactly be in that the thing that is the highest on the SIMD map, that is in the highest 5% or 10%, but they might be on the street next door. And often we also recognise that some of the postcodes for buildings, particularly cultural buildings, are not necessarily factored into the index in the way that then would be represented when we map against that. For example, the SITS, the Citizens Theatre in Glasgow, doesn't seem to show up as being part of the same area around it. However, the area around it is fairly high on the index of multiple deprivation. It's something we recognise. Those communities having the capacity, the social capacity to apply for funding, to having support and that ability to, you know, put time aside to apply for funding, or indeed, as we were talking earlier about assets, that ability to protect and keep hold of a community asset, that can be much more challenging in areas where there are other multiple challenges. Yeah. And, you know, working with colleagues in organisations like the Cora Foundation, where one of their place-based working involves putting a person into a place and then supporting people to determine what it is they need to do and what they need to do to support their community development. That's one of the ways that we might tackle that or support people in those areas to be able to achieve what they want for their cultural lives, not just by, you know, investing money in things. I think there's a lot of focus on funding, but actually that people capacity, the person, the creative spark in a community that can make a difference is really important in those areas too.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'm looking to see if there are any final questions from council members. It looks like we exhausted you this morning, so thank you very much.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you.
Yep, and no doubt we'll see you again over the course of our deliberations, but thank you very much for this morning. And we now move into private session.
Thank you.